basically a zoologist, but as a zoologist, I found life to be very challenging, very interesting, because you deal with life. No particular subject is bad, no particular subject is good. So how passionate you are, which made me what I am. And I took a fascination towards science, and through science to earthworms. Started working on earthworms, so today's topic, which I'm going to talk to you, would be for Earth's sake. Yes, our own Earth. For its sake, what all we can do. And when we look at it, three very important components in the environment: air, water, and soil. Though we consider some as non-living and consider some as living, we usually think that air is non-living. We always think that we are living, but we forget that when we remove the non-living air from our body, we become living. We also forget that water is non-living. We forget that we are living. We always think that we are living. Water is
non-living.
And remove the non-living water from my body, I become
non-living.
Now, this beautiful relationship which the earth gave us is something which brings us to an ecosystem. An ecosystem which has beautiful plants, birds, butterflies, and human beings. The problem is we put human beings first. Now, with this composition, two very important parameters: energy flows, nutrients, cycle. If you keep this as a maintenance, India, our own country, is very rich in biodiversity. This very rich biodiversity is very important for me, and in this biodiversity we indeed had cattle. Cattle played a very major role in our ecology. We started using them in agriculture, and when we started using them in agriculture, we also got their dung. And from this dung, what did we make? Cakes, which were used as fuel, which we call it as cow dung cakes. And we also used manure, which went back into the soil, which gave life to the soil. And then this tractor came in. And once the tractor came in, we said, we don't need you. But does a tractor give me dung? No. And in this composition, we felt, whenever we used a cattle for plow, the soil came up. And there was aeration of the soil. But when I brought in very heavy machinery on the soil became compact. Air went out from the soil. What happened to the soil organisms? They started dying. Fine. And that made me think, soil is a dynamic system. Do you agree? Yes. Because soil can imagine, soil can think, soil can also probably have a brain. Yeah. Because when you have a pit and put any biomass into it, what happens to it? Decomposes. But when you put a seed into it, it germinates. So a soil can distinguish what it has to decompose, what it has to germinate. So soil's beautiful composition is created by a variety of soil organisms which live in the soil. Variety. A huge variety of soil organisms. And this soil organism should have organic matter, which we always call it in Tamil language as manvasanai, as a beautiful smell from the soil. And for that, you should have organic matter in the soil. And this organic matter in our soils has started depleting. And then came this magic word in the society. What is the magic word? Echo. Echo means home. Home. If I study about the home, it is called as ecology. But if I evaluate the home, it is economy. The problem is today there is a clash between the two. And in this clash, something burns. And what burns is? Ecology. Because everybody wants? Economy. Right? So then the chemical intensification started in our country. And in this chemical intensification, we started dumping so many chemicals in the form of fertilizers and pesticides that our own state, Tamil Nadu, always ranks number 3. Andhra Pradesh and Punjab kids keep competing with each other as to who should be number 1, right? And though the governments say that our productivity is increasing, our productivity per acre or per hectare after 2000 has started decreasing. Fine. Our farmers use a lot of pesticides, but they do not use any protective mechanism themselves. And most of these pesticides and chemicals go down into the water and contaminate our groundwater. Many children in villages are suffering with chemical contamination, and our soils are becoming barren. Too much of soil, too much of salts, and the soils are becoming barren. The typical example of a farmer in Madanapalli. Wonderful farmer, has a beautiful farm. You are able to see a lovely tomato farm. And what is the marginal flowers you find over there? Beautiful yellow flowers. What do you think they are? Marigold, marigold. Marigold is an excellent pest repellent. So I congratulated that farmer. Wonderful man, you have done a wonderful job. And my farmer told me, no man, I'm growing them because somebody pays me good money. So I said, what do you use for tomatoes? He said, I use endosulfan, one of the dirtiest pesticides created by man. Very corrosive. I asked him to show me his hand, and his hand is completely corroded. Now, this also goes into our stomachs and corrodes our stomachs. Down south in Theni, you find many farmers use this, even for chilies. So most of the vegetables get infested with chemical pesticides. That so much of pesticide goes into the soil, and our own experiments have proved that our soils are becoming barren, without microorganisms and without fungi, which mainly act on decomposing, on as a decomposer organisms. And then we burn a lot of things on our farms, because we believe that ash is good for the soil. But when I go and see as to what is burning over there, this is what is burning over there. So we are also contaminating our soils with lots of materials which are not supposed to go into the soil. And we all suffer, most of us suffer with various diseases. And these diseases, as they increase, this is what has happened over a period of time. A for? B for? C for? D for? Very good, children. But in future, children will not understand this language because something else will become popular, and that would be A for anemia, B for bronchitis, C for cancer, and D for? So where are we moving? Where are we heading? So what we eat and drink, is it safe? No. Are there any alternatives? Yes, there are some safe alternatives. One of them is Vermitech, using earthworms for composting purposes, using earthworms. The whole world has several varieties of earthworms, and India alone has more than 500 species of earthworms. But we can classify them as surface living earthworms, which live above the surface of the soil, the column worms, which keep burrowing, and the bottom living earthworms. Now, in these earthworms, you find these are all varieties which we find in South India, in Tamil Nadu, beautiful earthworms, the surface, the subsurface, and the bottom living. And these earthworms are used for composting purposes. You know, vermicompost from that. Fine. Is vermicompost simple? Very simple. What do you need? Cow dung cake. Where do you get cow dung cake? Where do you get cow dung cake?
From the cow.
From the cow. But where do you buy them from? They are available online. Now, and then you multiply them, and then you can have beautiful compost produced from it. And this is an excellent manure which goes back into the soil, gives back life to the soil. Now, in these compositions, you find you can prepare it very easily. You have any material at the base, you load it up with any of the biomass you have, but you require an organic input to be added so that it multiplies microorganisms. So what is the source of microorganism? Again, it is cow dung. Or any fermenting fruit juice or any fermenting curd can be used as an inoculum. Keep adding it up and you just cover it up. The temperature goes up inside. This temperature is very important for me. It destroys unwanted microorganisms, unwanted pathogens. And then we turn it over, produces steam after 15 days or so. And in about 30 days, 35 days to 40 days, the whole pile comes down. It is cool enough and a rich food for the earthworms to eat. The earthworms eat this and they produce manure which is used as vermicompost. This goes back into the soil. Do it at home. No, sir, I don't want earthworms. I don't feel happy, right? Some of us feel that earthworms, no, I don't want to. Use 7 pots at home. Call them as Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Sunday's waste, chop it, put it in one pot, add a little bit of cow dung, or a little bit of curd, or a little bit of fermented juice, put some soil. Monday's in Monday, Tuesday's in Tuesday. You come back to Sunday after 7 days. In a month, how many times do you add in the pot? 4 times. Just stir it up. For a small family, it takes around 4 to 6 months for all the pots to be filled up. Leave for another 15 days. Then in one, you plant okra, that is lady's finger. In one, you put brinjal, which is eggplant. In one, you put spinach. You have your organic garden at home. Lovely? Yes. Otherwise, just make a pit in the soil, 3 feet wide, 1.5 feet deep. Take the soil, put it around, put all the waste inside. After a few days, grow smaller plants inside and bigger plants outside. You have your own nutrition garden. You can design pits, and we came out with this particular design. I'd like to share this to the audience and to all the people who will be watching it, a simple tank which could be made where compost can be prepared. This could be extended even with holes at the base so that leachate goes out and can be used. I'm very proud to say that Tamil Nadu government has taken up an initiative The Institute for Rural Development has taken up further, where many demonstrations have taken place. People have carried it further to produce vermicompost in their own sheds and give it to the people. Several NGOs have permitted us to do these programs even in temples. Take it forward, teach people, and people are interested. There are lots of successful efforts that have been taking place, proved on the field, where we can definitely confirm that these organic components can be excellent in producing wonderful vegetables for the people. Economics has been worked out, which works out cheaper than the chemical inputs, and they're relatively independent, not just for people to consume as well as to produce, but for the soil. The soil maintains its low pH, the soil's nutrient content improves, the soil carbon improves, which gives us the manvasana of the soils. Now this not only does that, but even the humic acid content, the bacterial content, as well as retention of moisture. Water retention for us is very important today, because water is essential. We will all agree that when we take food, and if there is too much of salt in the food, what is the first thing I would require? So when you put too much of salt in the soil, what does the soil want?
Water.
So you change the system and use manure or compost, these materials have the potential to hold moisture and give it back to the soil, and that's beautiful. Where should I go and look for inputs? Should I buy them from shops? No. I must look for inputs. And when I want to look for inputs, who is the greatest scientist on the farm?
Earthworm.
There is one gentleman, Professor Goat. Goats are very, very attractive animals. Goats are very sensitive animals. They can eat all sorts of plants. The plants which a goat does not eat has pest repellent properties. So take the goat with you, and the goat goes watching everywhere, and the goat says, you take the plant. Make a squash out of it. And this is an excellent pest repellent you can use on your feet, which is safe for consumption and doesn't affect anyone. Right? So for rural environments we feel. And from this you can prepare foliar sprays. Lots of foliar sprays can go back into the market. One of them is vermi wash, liquid fertilizer prepared from the worms. The problem is this vermi wash is different, where the worms create burrows and the water passes through these burrows and we create or collect that. That was the first unit I had prepared in 1982. Costed me 200 rupees, but many farmers were not able to afford 200 at that time. So 50 rupees, 10 rupees. It is not the container, it is the content that matters. So when you use any content, please be very clear that vermi wash is clear from different from vermi leachate. Because many people think, take vermi compost, soak it in water, that is also vermi wash. That is not vermi wash, because their parameters are different. When you start looking at it, various nutrient contents are richer in vermi wash than in vermi leachate. So you must try to understand why we use the particular thing. Combinations have been worked out. Panchakavya is one of the excellent nutrients which can be used on soils. When we use a combination of vermi wash and panchakavya, we find beautiful xylem vessels inside plants growing, children, so that the plant looks healthy, no blood pressure, right, for the plants. The chromosomes are healthy, and they also have wonderful compounds, because we have worked at the molecular nature of these compounds. So they have plant growth promoter substances which help the plants grow beautifully. And these healthy plants can be taken. Just look in your kitchen. Ask your grandmothers at home that why do we take rasam? Because it not just helps in digestion, but it also helps in removing some of the bad qualities of our digestive system. These things have components like asafoetida, they have garlic, they have other components in it. And rasam today is sold as a wonderful Malgathwani soup in 5-star restaurants, right? Make use of those components from the kitchen. You prepare excellent pest repellents in your own gardens. Very simple pest repellents can be prepared. And please always remember that heirloom seeds are our native seeds. These seeds are very important for us, because farmer used to have his own seeds. Today we have companies coming up with seeds, and we are slowly moving from biodiversity to genetic slavery. For us, food is medicine. For us, food is medicine. We don't want medicine in food. Is that clear, children? We don't need genetically modified seeds, because we wanted to bring in biotechnology, genetically modified brinjal seeds. This is a recent slide sent by a friend of mine who is running an organization. They have 21 varieties of brinjals just in Tamil Nadu. India has almost 100 varieties. Should we depend on one variety? Not necessary for us. We want to bring in genetically modified mustard. This again is a genetic technology which is not essential for our country at this point of time. Several experiments have to be carried out before we make our own, because we have a rich biodiversity. And genetic modification usually has or overshadows our own biodiversity. Water, is it essential? Yes. And we waste a lot of water. Am I right? Yes. And where do we use maximum water? Washing machines and bathing. Now this water has only soap in it. If I remove the soap, I can use the water. Yes?
Yes.
So what do I use? I use simple plants like Canna indica. Can you? Yeah. If you have this sort of a plants and make water pass through them, the water passes through the pebbles, along with plants like Canna indica or colocasia, one of these plants, and you get beautiful, good water coming out, which you can use for your garden, which you can use for recharging the soil, and also use for flushing the toilets. So this lovely water can be put to use, and these are the three varieties of plants which are generally used. Very simple techniques we will have to do, because water management is very important. Children, whenever I walk around, and if it rains, and if I hold an umbrella, where does the water fall? On my head or around me? Well, I don't carry an umbrella. There's a well-grown tree. I go and stand under the shade of the tree. A few drops of water may fall on my head, but most of the water falls around the tree. Why should water fall around the tree? Because nature is an excellent teacher. What does nature teach us from that? The water falls over there because the roots that drink are over there. So when you go back to your homes and you want to water your plants, water where the canopy is and not where the trunk is. Is that clear to you? Well, in that the roots will be able to consume, and that's what we have been teaching farmers. To make trenches where there are canopies, and then you provide them with material, you provide them with water, and it's being taken up by plants. And how much of water should I take? Now supposing I feel thirsty, I want to take water, what will I take water in? A glass. If I want to have a bath, a bucket. If I want to swim, a pool. Now how much of water is required for the plant? To swim, or to bath, or to drink? So water management is very essential for us. And for all this work to be successful in the ecosystem, in the environment, for the environment, what is the most important word?
Management.
Please, children, pronounce the word without the last letter T.
Manage.
Manage human beings. Without the last letter N.
Manage me.
Yes, for environment, what we should do? Manage
me.
If we can manage ourselves, we can manage others. And that is management. So let us all put our hands together to see to it that we do something for Earth's sake, or for Earth's sake, and make Earth again a beautiful what? Planet, which we would always love to inherit and share with our next generation. Thank you, and all the best.